Arvind sir.
Yeah, okay.
As you're not physically present here, on behalf of you, we are giving memento to you. Giving
and
it
I
to
think Dr. Shiva Prasad sir can get it, and on behalf of me, okay.
yes, sir.
Okay, right. Thank you. Thank you very much.
We'll soon send it by post. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
On behalf of Arvind sir, Meenal sir is receiving the memento.
Thank you, Minaj. Thank you, Vishal.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for detailed presentation and chairpersons for their active participation. Thank you very much. And we'll move ahead with the panel discussion. Our moderator for today's panel discussion is Dr. Ganeshan Gopalakrishnan. And other panelists are Dr. Aruna, Dr. Johan Philip, Dr. Ramanujam, Dr. Samala Nivedita, and Dr. Pavan Kulkarni. I all welcome them to the panel discussion. Did they join? Yeah, okay. Now I would like to introduce our moderator. He is the senior most and experienced psychiatrist. We are pleased to have you, sir, as a moderator for today's panel discussion. Dr. Ganeshan Gopalakrishnan is a retired professor and worked as HOD of Psychiatry, MVJ Medical College, Bangalore. He pursued his MD from PGI Chandigarh and MBBS from Thanjavur Medical College, Chennai. He was ex-CEO and Chief Consultant Psychiatrist at Soumanasya Hospital, Tamil Nadu. He served as past president of Indian Association of Social Psychiatry, World Psychosocial Rehabilitation Indian Chapter, as well as IPS Tamil Nadu. He is the recipient of Dr. Venkoba Rao Lifetime Achievement Award 2013 and Dr. M.S. Ashraf Award IMA Tiruchirappalli 2013. Sir, we welcome you. Please carry on, sir. Over to you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Good morning to every one of you present at the venue and people who are online to hear this wonderful panel discussion. We have five panelists, and it's my pleasure to introduce first the topic and then the speakers on behalf of the topic, which they will be doing it justifiably for about 12 to 13 minutes. And then we will take on discussion, and people who want to ask a question, please go ahead and ask it on the chat box. We will be able to take it up either after the presentation for a few minutes or a little later. I have five presenters, and all of them I'd like to introduce. First, Dr. Ramanujam, who is the present head of the Department of Psychiatry at Tirunelveli Medical College in Tamil Nadu. He's well-known, good speaker, and very much interested in anthropology and social psychiatry. I hope we will have lots of to hear from you on this topic, the smartphone use during the pandemic in the educational institutions, the pros and the cons of it. My second speaker is going to be Samala Nivedita, who is from Telangana, and she works as a civil assistant surgeon, and she will also join us to talk about the same subject, the pros and the cons, and whatever is the experience that people have had it over a period of time. I would like to introduce next to Aruna Edilal. She is the professor and head of Department of Psychiatry at Mangalore, Father Muller's Medical College. She's a good speaker. I've heard her many times before. I'm sure she will be able to give some of the best on the topic. Next is, of course, John, who is the son of my very close friend, Philip. We were all together. And John is going to, he's a consultant psychiatrist helping his dad at Cochin. And he graduated from Ramchandra Medical College, he's MD. And then I would like to introduce Dr. Pavan Kumar Kulkarni, who is the present head of the Department of Psychiatry at CAMS Karimnagar. Thanks for his last minute joining us, and it's a great pleasure. And I am sure all the speakers will be able to, panelists will be able to take on the topic interestingly within the next 1 hour, because we just have 1 hour. And I'm sure if you can, each of you would go first talk for about 5 minutes or less than 5 minutes, so that we will have to take it as and when it comes and then screw up to the discussions over a period of next 60 minutes. May I have the first speaker? Of course, you know, I would like to just give a brief introduction about smartphone use. Number one is smartphone has become inevitable in these days of pandemic. COVID is not yet over. So we have to wait for things to happen in the next few hours, first few days, or to pass through the crisis and then see what happens. And the institutions are almost closed. Even the examination is going to be on online basis. So this is the reality. But is smartphone the answer to learning is a debatable question. And there are people who have problems in obtaining a smartphone. There are number of all of you must have seen on the newspapers how people sell their cows, people sell their properties, and people sell their small belongings to buy the child a smartphone. That's a reality. And you know, 50% of Indians are still having an access to smartphone. That's a reality. Next part of it. And are we talking about something which is going to be a transitory phenomena, or is it going to be a part of the academic system in the years to come? I think all of us will have to wait and watch. And I'm sure we can start the discussion with panel discussion first. Can I request Dr. Ramanujam to go ahead with his presentation, please? Dr. Ramanujam?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. At the outset, good morning to one and all. And I sincerely extend my thanks to the organizers for having chosen me and given me this opportunity. Am I audible?
Yes, you are very much audible. Yes.
Thank you. Thank you. It should not be a talking to self. So thank you for giving me this opportunity. And that's such a wonderful opportunity. And looking at the title, it is the smartphone use in the educational institutions in post-COVID scenario. So that is the COVID is not at over. It is in its peak. We are all experiencing. And the smartphone usage has become the dictum. The only way by which education is obtained is through online. So psychiatry, unlike any other branch of medicine, is closely related to society. We cannot take away the social issues. And unlike other branch of medicines, where the clinical disease does not are not altered by the society, but our branch, the psychiatry, the diseases or the manifestations as well as the society changes causes newer disease, the biopsychosocial model. So currently the online classes affects both the biology, the psychology and the social aspect of the children. So we have to look into all the aspects. And internet use, as the moderator has rightly pointed out, has not, even though it is huge, it has not penetrated to the entire community. And we don't know how the lesser privileged children will go to the go through the education. And already in our state, almost the same scenario in many states, children from the government school, they have missed one precious year of education. And all the in our state also, the education was supported by some videos broadcasted through TV channels, but I don't think that will be anywhere match near. Even the online classes are not anywhere matched to the real-time classes. So what are all the biological changes? What are all the psychological changes that occur in the children? And what are both pros and cons we can have? There are, I am not denying that there are advantages in social and online classes, but we should also look into the disadvantages both in the biological, psychological, as well as in the social. The child, the school is a social unit. The child not only learns education or information alone, not only how information processing, it learns the social learning, the peer group learning, and the instantaneously it shares so many things, not only
educational aspect and other things also. Though how these things are affected by online classes and how we are going to, and the children are adapted. They are very much adjusted. Some children, they may prefer these online classes than the real-time school, especially children with social anxiety. And we don't know how these, even the school education considers all children as unique. But even then, there will be some allowances will be given for slow learners and children with learning disabilities and other difficulties. How these online classes will cope up with children with learning disability and other online class problems like social anxiety children. We don't know how this the problems may arise, but we have to be very watchful in the few years to come, as this may be a norm. Whether this online classes will be just a supplement to the regular classes after the COVID era, or it may be a major mode of teaching, we have to discuss. And we also should look into the other aspects like the distractibility of the children, falling prey for cyber bullying, internet porn addiction, internet game addiction, and so many other diseases like lack of arising due to lack of exercises and physical activity, and all these things. And also we have to take into account the teacher's perspective, the student's perspective, and also the parent's perspective. The triad of the education, all are already, even the our current education system, we see first the child comes to our OP, and then the parent comes and say, I am stressed. And after some time or the next day, the teacher also comes to our OPD and says that I am stressed because of these children. So the triad we have to address. And how we are going to, teachers, many of the teachers, how are they equipped, are they empowered to deal with these online classes? Whether they are capable of conducting all these things, we have to deal with this. So we have to look into all these aspects, the pros and cons, and then we should have a discussion, and we have to, I think as a unit, we have to make some guidelines to restrict and how to go about in near future. Thank you, sir. Sir?
Sir, kindly unmute, sir. Gopal, sir.
Am I audible now?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Dr. Amanujam has, opened the Pandora's box of trying to understand the consequences of the use and the reality and the challenges ahead. Now I would request Dr. Nivedita to go ahead with her presentation for a few minutes as Dr. Amanujam did, so that we will have enough of fruitful discussions at the end of the debate. Nivedita, please.
Hello, sir. Namaste to all. Am I audible, sir?
Yes, you are audible. Go ahead.
Thank you, sir. Namaste to all. Namaste to everyone. A warm welcome to the CME, and thanks to the organizers to give me this opportunity. Okay, quickly moving on to the topic. Coming to the topic, according to the survey, widely circulated newspaper has given a report that the usage of internet by India has been on a rise since past decade. But the rise, according to the survey, from 2019 Jan to 2020 Jan has been 23, which was an all-time hike. But from Jan 2020 to Jan 2021, the rise has been about 63%. And if we zoom into this data, this has mainly been because of the education and academics being online. And many of the...
Sorry to interrupt you. There is a disturbance, ma'am. Can you hold your mouthpiece near to your mouth? There is a disturbance.
Closer to my first thing. Yes.
Yeah, sorry.
Yes, am I on? Is it clear now?
Yes,
Yes, ma'am, you can proceed. Yeah, it's clear.
Yes, yes. So I think I've missed the point. I was just talking about a newspaper survey which published that the internet usage in 20 to 21 Jan has been increased by about 63%. And I was talking about, we zooming into the data, and we see that it has mainly been because of the education system and academics going online. And since a long time, India has been criticized for the very less usage of internet in its education system. And India has actually achieved the target overnight due to the pandemic. But if we zoom into this data furthermore, it has been, what has it cost for the digitalization to happen? It has been many people, parents of students, trying to procure, as sirs were telling before, to buy these new gadgets and smartphones and other things for their kids to, so that their education is not hampered. But they had to do this in the time when they had lost their livelihood, some of them lost their jobs, and sources of income were reduced, and they had to procure these things in that time so that they can support the education system. Okay, well, coming to that, another newspaper survey has also published somewhere in November, December, that most of 80% of the students use smartphone for supporting their online classes compared to the bigger devices like laptops. And they also made a suggestion to the teachers and the programmers of the online classes that these classes should be made for smaller screens so that these children are supported by it. And with this foreground, we can say that the biggest pro point in the whole thing is that the academic year was not lost, as it happened in 1980 due to the Spanish flu pandemic time. I think back then, all the students lost 1 to 2 years of their academic year, which did not happen this year. And thanks to the technology and the developers of technology, they have actually saved lives. Because had this not happened, it would lead to many dropping out of their academics or education in order to take up their jobs. Think about the final year students of various graduations and post-graduations. Maybe 2 years of time is taken off from them where they're not able to perceive their courses. I think they have no other options. If they are not coming from a strong economic background, they'll have to drop it down and look for their sources of income or livelihood later on. So in a way, the technology and the internet use, the biggest pro point is that it has actually saved time and saved academic years and prevented many from dropping out. And coming to the, I've asked a few of my friends and also patients who were teachers who had to go about these online classes, and some of the students also who had come to the clinic, and my kith and kin, and parents, of course, they have also contributed. And I've come out with some interesting points they had to tell. They said that, you know, the commute time has come down, the child is safe at home. And regarding the safe at home, I would like to tell, as a person working in a general hospital setup, I have come to know that the overall pediatric OPD has come down in this 1 year. If you see, if it is the COVID and pandemic, but then children suffering from URTIs, GEs, and other things have drastically come down. The OPD, the pediatric OPD, has come down in the past year. And that is probably because of the cutdown. 80% of the pediatric OPD would be because of communicable diseases. And just not the COVID, it has prevented the children from many other illnesses that would contribute to the sickness in the usual year. Even the dengue malaria season, I think the cases were far less, and this could be because of it. You can look at it as a pro point or a positive point about it. And many children had to say that, you know, the commute, especially from larger cities, the commute time from the school to the house and from house to the school, the commute time has come down, and their tiredness and all that that it used to take has gone. And kids have access to new technology. Before, I think as Indians, we are all skeptical about using the internet and smartphones and other things. Many of them were, we don't know actually, as parents and as elders, we are as they say we are internet immigrants, we are not native to them, whereas the millennials are native to internet. So we are actually skeptical because we don't know, and everything that is unknown is a trigger factor for fear. So we don't allow our children to explore and all that. And because of the classes going online, I think we are all a little bold. We all pushed ourselves to learn and know about technologies. Even the parents had to support their children at home with the internet glitches and other things. And so they have learned to solve this problem. And it, this pandemic has given them an opportunity to learn a little more about the internet and its usage, and that's how the 63% has been achieved. And then children had many online courses from all over the world. I think looking at these courses, I think the teacher and student barrier that would be there was gone. Any teacher from any part of the world could teach a student from any part of the world. So before, the relationship between the countries was mainly decided by the political background and the defense backgrounds maybe. But then the internet has given a chance for the civilian population also to form a relationship between the countries, I would say. So coming to my son, he has a friend from South Korea and America during this pandemic time. Because of the online courses and the games and other things, they have been able to come up with. So these things have been on the positive side, and from the negative side point, as we have all discussed, it has costed the parents. Some of them would not afford their income and other things, and of course the long screen time we are all worried about, then the effect on eyes and the teacher student interaction. Most of the teachers feel that that is not there. The teacher doesn't have a control over the child, whether the child can simply mute and off the video and the child is lost from the class. The teacher doesn't know if the child is listening. And the biggest complaint from the teachers has been that the children are cheating during their exams, because the exams being online, they can simply keep their books and, you know, they can have help. Even parents are helping them from the other side. So the marks that they're achieving, there is no notes keeping. So all these could be hampering their academic skills, which have taken a break, a long break. I don't know if this pandemic, this second wave goes on for a long time. Maybe it will be 2 years of online and the separation of teachers and students. So I think the teachers are worried that children may lose their skills of writing and making notes and, you know, keeping the discipline of school in time. And of course, as Ramanujan sir was rightly saying, school simply doesn't teach academics. It also teaches, it's a mini model for the young individuals to form their adjustment skills, interacting with people, their social skills. So they learn how others will react and how they have to behave. And a lot of social skills are contributed. More than education, I think it is this personality development, which how to adjust with the watchmen in the school, how to adjust with the other people in the school, not just their peers, with the teachers, what plausible answers to give so that the teacher will listen, how to explain themselves. All these are things, skills that the children learn if they go to school. Otherwise, they are dampened. And definitely, this is a long gap, and children will have their own problems when they go back to the schools again for at least 3 to 4 months. Then coming to the negative side, as everybody said, physical activity has drastically come down, leading to a lot of childhood obesity. So we are shifting from communicable diseases to non-communicable diseases in these children. I think many children have become obese by eating because they don't have any other thing, and the parents have only to offer them some food and other things if they're able to keep them calm. They're sitting either in front of the TVs or the screens and then eating, and that is leading to a lot of obesity. Then many parents also have to say that there has been a rise in sibling rivalry. I don't know if I'm right in that, but it is the day, it is the information which some of my parents gave me, is that then before, I think the fights among siblings have increased, and they have it is acting as a lot of interaction time between them at home is leading to a lot of problems in their communication and other things. And of course, the mothers are the worst hit during this pandemic, I believe. They had to do all the jobs. You know, already mother, being a mother is a multi-role versatile situation. And here they had to be the school management sometimes. They had to be the teacher. They had to be the supporter, tutor, everything. And cook, maid, everything for their children. And I think mothers have taken out the stress. They have been the shock absorbers for the stress during this pandemic time. And I'm working in a COVID center. I can see that, you know, the first wave and the second wave, the difference we see in a COVID center in the OPD is that many people are now women who are coming up with the infections. In the first wave, I think they were restricted, protected from the infection. And now I think we have more and more cases. The OPD is overloaded with females with infection. And that could be because of, you know, the stress taking the toll on them, or the immunity, or the other things, or they being just relaxed. People are tired of 1 year of being under stress. Almost everybody is burnt out. That is what I see. And of course, there is one critical comment about the negative aspect of this, is that parents who have been, both parents working, had to leave their children back home in some way or the other with a little this thing. So the risk of sexual exploitation of unattended kids left at home has also seen a high, is what some parent had to report and some sources had to report to me. This is it from my side. Thank you so much for the opportunity.
Dr. Nivedita, thank you so much, because I was about to tell you that we will take it up, because you have brought in a lot of interesting things about children. One way you said, you know, the less in the pediatric OPD, and they don't go to schools, the school is empty, are used for some other purpose, and that better cleaning happens in the school. So number of things are happening, but at the same time, you know, the challenges are very much ahead and very much noted, and the children are left with just 2 hours for only online learning. You know, that's a contingent time, you know, screen time.
Yes.
Most governments have already put it 2 hours to 3 hours. So what do they do the rest of the time? And working parents leave the children. It's a real challenge. And then you say one time, you say that smartphone phone is required, but at the same time, you don't allow them to use for a Netflix or something else, which they will obviously do. It is not around the place, and you are giving them 2 GB. And again, how often the 2 GB works for most people is a real challenging question, because the bandwidth, and you know what, even as professionals, what do we see in Zoom on all meetings? That definitely will be cut off at least for 5 minutes. If it is a 20-minute program, 5 minutes is cut off. So that is the reality. And then the Guru Chela, which we are always proud of in this country, is just not going to be happening.
Yes.
And an imaginary head or imaginary person, how close is it? I mean, I don't know. We have to wait for the times to see. And we are yet through the pandemic. So let us see what lessons we are going to learn in this time. Thank you, Nivedita. We will keep up
our time
and then go ahead. Please wait for the comments of the other people who are on to be making the presentation. Can I now request Dr. Aruna to go ahead? Dr. Aruna, please, if you can go ahead. Dr. Aruna, are you on the line?
Can't hear, sir.
Hello?
Dr. Aruna?
Hello, can you hear me, sir?
Yes, I can hear you. I'm able to see you and hear you. Go ahead, please.
Okay, sir. First of all, good morning to everybody. And I thank IPS SZ for having me here as a panelist. And I am very honored to be representing my state, that is Karnataka chapter. We are a very vibrant community or society of psychiatrists over here. And I think one of my seniors recommended my name. Thanks for him also for recommending to this August panel, where I got to meet many others also. And thanking my chairperson especially for the discussion we had yesterday. I will go on with a few words worth of what I thought about this topic. One thing is the title says it is in post-COVID scenario. It is not yet post-COVID, unfortunately. So whatever we tell today is just a supposition or a hypothetical situation rather than a real one. So the time is just left to see that what we the smartphone usage in educational institutions will be in the future. The second point what I would like to see is whatever the guidelines come or whatever the rules the societies or the educational institutions make, it is a lesson for us to know that it is just transitory and it is cross-sectional. See, there was a time when all universities banned smartphones in the schools and colleges. But now a time has come where a whole cycle has come. You can tell that the smartphone karma has come to bite them in their behinds, and that is how the smartphone has become so much necessary for continuation of education. The plus point, as Nivedita ma'am told or Ramanujam sir told, is it provided a lot of succor in such situations where offline education was not possible. And a recent survey what was done in India, maybe it was done in December 2020, as recent as that, a study of COVID, during the time of COVID, students were heavily dependent on smartphones. 80 to 90% in Kendriya Vidyalayas and Navodaya Vidyalayas, the NVs what they call, 84 to 88% of students told that they had access to online education only through smartphones. And rest of the people, 10 to 12% used laptops or desktops. So you can imagine the amount of smartphone usage, not just internet usage, smartphone usage as such have increased drastically, and people were forced to buy smartphones for their kids. I am not telling that it is bad. It has provided a lot of succor. But at the same time, we saw an epidemic of mental health problems among children and parents also. So this triad also had this problem. And it is not only children that these people were in, it was also seen in adults. Like teachers like me had to adopt to online teaching. Like, as much as I enjoy tossing a chalk piece to the dozing student in my class, I miss that very much. I had to adapt to online technology where I don't know whether the student in front of me is just switching it on and going to toilet or watching a movie on his laptop. So I really don't know what is happening on the other side. So there's a big trust deficit between the teacher and the student, which is building up due to this online.
That is the truth. That is the truth.
We have to believe that they are listening to us. We really don't know what is happening behind the screen. Yeah. And one of the good or one of the interesting theories when I studied this, what came up was effective neuroscience theory. I think the application of it is very much applicable to this time of the online education. That was that is not a new theory. That is brought by Panskep et al. In 1998, and they proposed that there were 7 primary emotions that have been homologously conserved across the mammalian brain, which functions as tools for our survival and well-being. And among this, the positive side, there was the seeking or the curiosity part, the care and the love and the lust circuits and the play circuits. All these emotions which have been mapped, they're actually negatified or nullified in children who were taking online classes. And also, on the negative side, the emotions of fear, sadness, and anger. This also have been mapped as one of the primitive emotions of the mammalian brain. During the COVID-19 pandemic, what actually happened was the lockdown, the social distancing, and a closed kind of closed offline education system that led to the caretakers paying less attention to their children. That meant that more screen time, more unmonitored screen time for the children. And parents were working from home. They were preoccupied with work. There was fear of losing their own jobs and fear of financial loss, and also getting frustrated. And there was sadness and anger in the caregivers themselves. So children had to spend so much of time unguarded over the monitors, over the screens. And this led to digital overuse naturally. And they were reported to be more sad, more irritable. And there was very much few play, or what we call that going outside and getting hurt and coming back. These kind of tumble play is very much less. And fear of the parents was carried on to the kids. So among the primary emotions, the positive ones like the seeking out or the play or the care, these were not stimulated enough, or it was understimulated, and hence the negative consequences were seen. And among the negative emotions, the sadness, the fear, or the anger, this was triggered and was in surplus. That is, it was overwhelmed. And this disbalance in the primary emotional system, that is what led to a lot of mental health problems, mainly being depression, anxiety, or adjustment disorder. A surge of adjustment disorders was seen. There were increase in ADHD symptoms. There was increase in substance use. There was increase in internet addiction, online gaming, and this kind of things. Internet exposure or being victims to child pornography, suicidal thoughts and acts, and also other behavior addiction and impulse control disorders were also on the surge. So in spite of seeing all this, we have to understand that we have to strike a balance, because smartphone has come, but it has not come to go. It has come to stay probably. So with that, and it has a lot of benefits also, which I will be telling when they give me a chance further on. What are the pros of the smartphone usage in educational institutions? But having said this, we have to understand that there are definitely pros and cons. That's why the subject has come up. We have to strike a right balance in the smartphone usage. And for responsible students with self-discipline, it has been wonderful. They didn't have any problems. Thus, I still think that the control or the responsibility or the will to control something should come from inside. When that is there, these technologies work wonders in children's life and also in adults' life.
Thank you, Aruna. I think that's a wonderful beginning. I think you have pointed number of good things that are to happen, that should happen, and there should be a judicial use. It will probably come through. Now we would go ahead because of time factor, but I would request John.
A very good morning to all of you. Am I audible?
You can go ahead. Yes, please.
Thank you, sir, for that lovely introduction. First of all, I'd like to thank the organizers for this opportunity to participate in this wonderful panel discussion. I must say this time we've had an excellent turnout for our midterm CME, and this definitely reflects the quality of presentations at the CME. Now, the topic, smartphone usage in educational institutions, I don't know if we can call it the post-COVID era yet. We are still yet to see the peak in May is what we hear. But this is an interesting topic of concern to all of us, not just as psychiatrists, but also as parents and also as faculty and teachers in medical colleges. And something that I'd like to quote is an article that came out in the Telegraph, it's on the BBC website, about 2 weeks back. This is Gavin Williamson. He's the UK Secretary of State of Education. And he says something very specific. He says phones can act as a breeding ground for cyberbullying, and social media can damage mental health. And this is something that they were clear about. And what they wanted was the fact that they wanted schools to make its own policy. But he believes that mobile phones should not be used during the school day. And that is a policy that we are seeing that is coming out of this COVID pandemic situation. On the one hand, there are many pros. There is no denying the potential for phones as an educational tool in itself. One, it definitely helps in social distancing. And online classes have been a huge boon as students can use smartphones instead of laptops due to the lower cost. And this is something that we've seen in a lot of our children who come to us. This helps students interact better with teachers and faculty. And something that I would like to share with respect to Kerala is that the Kerala government has a Kite Victor's YouTube channel. In fact, that was getting over 15 crore views in a month. And something that we did see in the media, reported in the media, was a fact that about 15 lakh rupees was the monthly revenue that was donated every month to the Kerala Chief Minister's Disaster Relief Fund as a result of children watching classes on YouTube. So this is definitely something that we looked at. And now that classes have opened for college-going students and exams are still in place, smartphones do help parents and guardians to stay in touch with their children during the COVID-19 pandemic, thereby ensuring their safety and well-being. But on the other hand, I would like to talk more about the cons. In fact, we talked about the BBC article that came out this month and Gavin Williamson's viewpoints. But definitely, this is something that can be a distraction. If we've looked at the social media platforms, a lot of children coming onto social media, not just Facebook and Instagram, but a lot of school children starting there on YouTube channels. Mm-hmm. And this is not in the hundreds or thousands. There are so many children, a lot of children who come to us as well, who have started their own YouTube channels and are not really focused on their education and studies as a result of access to smartphones and internet. And as was indicated earlier by Dr. Aruna as well, exposure to inappropriate content is something that is causing a major problem right now. How it will go ahead remains to be seen as we go into the pandemic further. But cyberbullying is definitely something that we are all concerned about. In fact, the other day I just drove by Infopark and there's a police station that is set up in Cochin for cyberbullying and online issues alone. And this is something that we all really need to look at and talk about, because exposure to predators, this is something especially on social media. We do find little boys and girls starting their own social media profiles and YouTube channels and things of the sort and being bullied with comments that are being public, and how this will impact their mental health over time is something we need to think about. Many researchers talk of a disconnect, the fact that smartphones and digital devices disconnect students from face-to-face social activities and communication. And for those of us who have kids at home and are attending online classes, not going out, this is something that we really don't want to encourage, but we are forced to due to the pandemic itself. And one last thing that I'd like to talk about is the fact that the theme for the CME itself is addiction. And substance addiction and behavioral addiction, I believe, are one and the same. It all goes down to brain wiring. And one drawback of smartphone use, especially in educational sector, is the fact that online gaming has come about in a big way. This may be a huge disadvantage. Gambling addiction, in fact, online poker and the so-called trading. A lot of people promote so-called trading and options trading, but it's in fact gambling. These are third-party websites that deal in apparently cryptocurrency and forex, and a lot of small children getting access to their parents' bank accounts and UPI handles and trading money, losing a huge amount. In fact, the High Court of Kerala had banned online poker websites some time back. How that will go as we go into the future remains to be seen. So with that, I will hand over the session to the next panelist. Thank you so much for listening.
Thank you, John. Thank you, John, for making very interesting perspectives on children and so more of abuse and what is there in store for us in the years to come. Many governments are worried, many organizations are worried, many NGOs are worried, but of course we are talking about only children. But the broad perspective of this panel discussion is on the whole educational system. Just not only schools, but colleges and, you know, professional institutions, research areas, because one-to-one has not been happening for quite some time. So there is a lot of threat, there are a lot of perceived threat, and there are some things which we don't have an answer. For example, timing. You know, what is the best time for a person to see what is the best time? And again, you were talked about very interesting thing about the abuse of, you know, gaming. Not just that, but also about, you know, people going online to abuse has been the source of debate. A number of my students have done that kind of work. And we did find that these are very interesting in Bangalore to see that how it has hurt number of children otherwise. So we'll come back to probably when we to get back to discussion. Now, I think I would request Dr. Pavan to go ahead with his presentation from Telangana, because they are the host and I'm sure you would have lots of things to say about the topic. Please go ahead, Dr. Pavan.
Good morning, sir. Thank you, sir. Am I audible, sir?
Yes, very much.
thank you, sir. Good morning, one and all, and I thank the organizers, Kishan sir and Vishal, for having me here. Though it's a last minute change, and I hope I can talk about this. Sir, like COVID-19, it's been like 1.5 year now, and it has affected all sectors in an unprecedented manner. And 1.5 year into the illness, and we do not know what it is actually going to have or happen in near future. So undoubtedly, it has affected all the sectors, and more so the education. And there are some positives out of it, and there are negatives out of it. The double mutant, triple mutations, what we are talking about it. Now, we are seeing the children. It is reported that this time, even the younger population is more affected with COVID-19. So what are the pros with having this online education, online smartphone usage or education in schooling? One is the safety of the children is taken care of by having them at distant at their home place. And education has also reached the remote places. And smartphone usage over the last 1 year has gone up from 38 to 75% in the last 1 year, according to the recent survey. And the another positive point out of it is the academic year is not lost. So these are the only pros that I can see. And coming to the cons, the ill effects are more because it is the pandemic we are dealing with. The cons we need to address more. And when it comes to the cons, we have to look at it in three-dimensional perspective what students, teachers, and parents are going through. And with respect to students, the peer-to-peer interaction, the learning has, of course, has come down because the syllabus concentration from the schools and managements, and the peer-to-peer interactions, less play time, and opportunity or chance of exposure to unauthorized sites and cyberbullying, as Dr. John was already telling it. So these are some of the things that the students are issues. When coming to the parents, monitoring from home is difficult for working parents. And not only monitoring, the economic burden of it also is different because some of, most of the times, their children are like, say, there are two kids, they have to have two separate equipments at the same time for attending these classes. So economical burden, the school fees and all these things are another issue. And monitoring and how the concern from the parent side will be like after the syllabus concession, the decisions taken by the respective governments, concession of the syllabus, how better the child is equipped with the knowledge going to the next standard is again a question. And teachers, coming to the teachers' perspective, how equipped are the, how ready are the teachers to this online education, whether how accessible, how comfortable are they with the technology that is coming up. And the teacher-student relation is the which is the essence is not there anymore. The earlier the teachers used to identify the students just by the face. Now having hundreds on a screen, you are having 100 windows, and what the student is doing, it is difficult for them to manage. So these are the some of the key issues that we need to look into. And yes, definitely it has affected all sectors. So with this thing, I would like to hand over the proceedings to the moderator, sir.
Okay. Pawan, are you done with, would you like to say anything more? You're done.
Yes, sir. That's most of it has already been mentioned, sir.
Yes, quite a lot of things have been covered, but still I would request people who are viewing this program to put their questions on the chat box so that we will take up one by one. We have still about 15 minutes to cover up and everybody to say a concluding remark. We will take for 2 minutes for each of them. It will be 10 minutes. So can I go ahead with some questions? Are there any? Can you tell me the organizers? Are there questions who are already there? Yes, Prasad.
Yeah, I would like to just congratulate all the speakers. They put a great perspectives in the view, but I just want to bring a newer thing which probably is not covered in the current presentation. The thing is, what we are finding of late in the last 4 months to 6 months, Now, internet and smartphone usage is a compulsion by the students as brought out by the by you and all the speakers.
Yeah.
But the newer problem which the parents are coming and breaking their heads is that when they are not observed, they are going to the sites of their favorite. It can be anything. It can be a gaming. It can be a thing. So this is one perspective which is visible to as a clinical cases for us. And that's a problem. And the only thing is constant supervision by the parents is probably the must. But I think I could see the wonderful things. The other thing, as I said today, for example, if we don't use smartphones, we are abnormal. We have come to a stage where if we don't use smartphones, we are
That's
abnormal
true.
Because
necessary,
smartphone
necessary
is the root.
Necessary, but desirable. Yes.
But I congratulate all the youngsters. I would call youngsters because I'm old. And
I should say still older.
But I'm young in heart. And Nivedita, Aruna, John, and everyone, and Pawan. Thank you very much for the nice perspective. It's really lovely to listen to each one of you. Yes.
We have, thank you, Prasad. We have still a lot of time to go through. If there are some other questions, if it is already on the chat box, please let me know. Otherwise, I will go ahead with asking a couple of things in case some questions are not available.
Sir, good morning, sir. We are calling from the organizing team. I'm one of the PG here, sir. I have a question for Aruna, ma'am.
Please go ahead.
There's a hypothesis that smartphones lead to a decrease in attention span, ma'am, due to various apps and constant viewing of other screens. What do you say about it, ma'am? Is there any evident research or what is your take on it, ma'am?
Aruna, yes. Please.
Am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Definitely, our cognitive neuroscience theories clearly point out that multitasking is not always multitasking and it doesn't suit everybody either.
Exactly.
When we multitask, we give half attention to each task and complete the tasks half attentively. That is not done. My professor always used to say me that if I ask you to do 10 dishes, that doesn't mean that you have to do 10 dishes all incompletely. That will not make even one dish palatable. So when we take up a task, I think we have to give it the purity of our attention. So when we are divided into multiple attentions, the screens come up. Let us leave children alone. They are not, their neuromodulation is not yet pruned. Let us take ourselves as examples. As we are doing this program or something, Myntra thing drops there. They will tell 80% of your favorite dresses and something else pops up. It says your Tata Sky deactivation is being done today. Go for it. And another thing pops up. So you are kind of distracted to the two or three things. And if you are not made up in your mind that I will focus on the one thing at task, definitely you're going to give less attention. And less attention always means less commitment towards that particular one project. And the results are going to be less fulfilling for even the receiver also when we give less attention to a particular task at hand. So I feel that all the neurocognitive theories point towards that. And for self-disciplined students, I have seen that it has been wonderful, this online education. And one thing which I didn't bring about the positive aspect of online education is it has taught a lot of integrity to our children. For one example, I will give you my own daughter, who was taking grade 10 pre-boards exam. She's not good at drawing. I'm very good at drawing. So I told her, shall I help you in the biology drawings of the kidney system or nephrology or cardiology part where she has to draw a human heart and a human nephron? You know what she told me? Your drawing is your drawing. Teacher is going to grade me for my drawing. So just teach me how to draw and I will draw it. It may not be as good as yours, but I want to see how much I draw and how much the teacher grades me on that. So this kind of concept, you know, where you have that self-integrity and that thing that is totally lacking in today's children. So I think this system of online examination is going to pump up that self-integrity. And it is not new. Open book concept is there in Western countries a lot, where you open the book and write exams. So I think these type of things will encourage more of concept learning, bring out the integrity in people and build up the moral fabric of our young generation also. So that is one of the positive aspects which I saw in online examinations. And yes, distraction is a great threat for education because whatever we learn, we need to remember it and recollect it. And unless the attention is fully focused on a task at hand, distraction definitely will lead to impaired learning.
That is true, Aruna.
May I add one minute, sir?
Yes, please. Please go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity. So the ADHD, definitely it worsens by the digital technology. There is, you can go and search digital distraction and digital dementia, two are the things. So ADHD in attention deficit and hyperactive, there's the novelty seeking is very high. So any stimuli they go, they get distracted and the attention span is very, very low. So as madam has rightly pointed out, when you start one thing, we get an explosion of so many stimuli in the digital teaching. Whereas we find that in the traditional, the school teaching, the children are in one controlled environment where their ADHD and the hyperactivity gets reduced. So this is not seen in the virtual world. So they have this digital distractibility. They start with learning what is Pythagoras theorem, and they end up learning what is the name of the daughter of Virat Kohli and Anushka Sharma.
Well said, but I think John, would you like to say something about distraction? Hello.
Am I audible now?
Yes.
Yeah, Dr. Arna clearly pointed out, you know, the fact that Facebook and Google, all these massive...
Remember, John, what happens normally when a person is on a smartphone, if they get a call, what do they do? So naturally, we're distracted, you know. There may be a notification because you can't stop number of events of the device, even in viewer. So you are forcibly into many things.
That's right.
Does it impair learning? That is the question.
That's that right. The fact that distractibility is a huge issue, and something that one is addicted to will keep on popping up in their Facebook page. And this is something that we see with children who make Facebook profiles and Instagram profiles early in life. And they really need to have that self-control in place. And they really, I think the whole idea of machine learning and artificial intelligence tries to tap in on this this addiction potential of individuals. And this is something that has been happening and something that we see in clinical practice day to day since several years. The fact that COVID has come about and people have got onto smartphones and internet in a big way has actually worsened that. And I think we should see that as a crisis. So I think that Dr. Arna detailed that very well. And that's something I'd like to point out.
Thank you. There is a question on the chat box. Can you just put it on again? There's a question from one of the students from CMC.
Sir.
Can you just
put the question on? Question,
no, can you put the question on? Because I'm not able to see it now. There is a question which has come to the chat box, which I was displaying.
Yes, sir. I'll write out the question, sir.
Yeah, please read out the question, please.
So, what's the verdict, sirs and ma'am? Is it a pro or a con?
Oh, is it a pro or a con? Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay. There aren't advantages. There is a... is it a compulsion? Of course, it is a compulsion for this generation to use smartphones. There are pros and cons. There is no doubt about it. But the problem is what you need to take, how much to take and when to take and what to take. Because there are some guidelines. The real guidelines are just not available. How long you can expose yourself to a smartphone without attending to what you need to do. For example, as most speakers have already said, you put on the phone on and then the child attends to something else and then comes back. Nobody would know. The parents are not there. The children are alone. And sometimes it is another sibling. And then the chat also goes on between the children. So these are all some reality issues and which we need to attend. And there are many things for which control is required, but who will teach control and what really you call it as control? And what you call is an addiction. And the problem is vulnerability to abuse exists whenever there is a use of an instrument or a device. So obviously we have to work on all this. And I think the speakers also can concentrate not just on children or schools, but also in colleges. Mostly, see, for example, medical college, do you think online learn, which is being recommended now, even with the NMC thing in a couple of days ago, that do you think it is going to be... use of smartphone during a class in the MBBS curriculum or for that matter engineering, is it going to be a feasible option? Please share your thoughts, please.
Sir,
if I may.
Sir, please go ahead.
Sir, for one, it is my personal opinion that MBBS can't be taught online, not fully at least. It is like learning to sail a ship or pilot a plane by reading a book about piloting. It is an alternative. We are in desperate times, so desperate times call for desperate measures. That is why we have gone online. But it should not be recommended as a norm. It is not the new norm. It's not the old norm. We shouldn't, as teachers, recommend online teaching for MBBS. It is not done. Without the cadaver, without the labs, without the bedside clinic, MBBS is not MBBS anymore. Exactly. And if somebody is doing an online exam as a patient, I would not go to that doctor. Seriously, exactly. That is my opinion.
I don't know, but the problem is, you know, already it is happening, whether we like it or not. The cadavers are just not there in some places. And secondly, there are not enough of, you know, even the so-called, some people use blackboards, you know, to write and then teach students. That is happening in engineering. That's happening in some of the labs also. In, you know, many of the institutions. But the problem is, if you have to have innovation, which you need, and then practical training to touch, how does a person feel like? How does a tumor feel like? It's impossible to get on the virtual line. It is not something purchasing something on an Amazon, saying that I do get the 3D value of it. You know that by the time it comes to you, you know, you can see the differences, be it a sari, be it something else, you can always make a difference. So smartphone cannot replace human being. That's the real part of it. And the Guru Chela, which this country has already gone through, has taught you a number of nuances of learning which a virtual system cannot give. For example, many people try to learn a number of things only from a textbook or a literature, but it is not a replacement hearing to somebody, because as Professor J.K. Nicky, who used to be my teacher, used to tell me every little thing, the nuances of understanding the ifs and buts and the way the person tries to communicate. These nuances are very important, cannot be replaced in a virtual world. It is impossible. Be it also, if you have to do a SWOT analysis, for example, even for a business study, it's very impossible to do a SWOT analysis if you don't look at the problem in a real term, in a real world scenario. So that way, smartphones cannot replace. But it is a good thing, because in the current times, it's a challenge. But how much we use it, how much we took it, take it for the betterment of the society. That's most important. And as I told you, see, many people can't afford the people. I have seen the story where in Madhya Pradesh, somebody sells a cow to buy a smartphone. Do you think it's reality? Where will you get the milk then? You won't get milk for the child. So the replacement is in topsy terms. Second thing is the bandwidth. Are we going to bandwidth for the amount of use in the whole country? And now you are saying you're going to go for a 5G, then the problem is all these things put a lot of strain on the system. And another thing is teachers are also not used to this kind of online teaching, because they have challenges. Many teachers, even medical teachers, I do see, number of them cannot do something when somebody is not around the place. They are good in telling somebody who is there with them, oh, come on, look at this. Did you not see this? What your mind does not know, you don't even see that. So this is something which cannot be replaced. But at the same time, I do realize smartphone is a necessity. I wouldn't call it as an evil, but it is a timely, because otherwise children would not have learned anything in last 1 year. So they have come, and we have to come to stay with COVID, with pandemic, with newer situations also that are likely to arise. And of course, you know, knowledge, like you said, online programs have good thing. Now everybody has started learning about robot technology. Everybody has started learning about artificial intelligence. These things just happen because so much of exposure and everything is freely available with no cost. Be it, most important universities in the world are offering it free of cost for the simple reason, let most people learn. And the iPod previously, but the problem is still the system is not foolproof. There are abuses. There are chances for children to abuse the system. At the same time, you have a number of limitations also. Would other speakers like to say something else? On if there are some other questions, I will take it up. Otherwise, I would like to end up.
Yes, sir. Sir, one point. There are two things learning. There is a synchronous learning and asynchronous learning. Synchronous learning occurs simultaneously. That is the feedback.
గ్యాలరీ మీకు
టీచర్స్ ఫ్రమ్ ది స్టూడెంట్
కన్వే అవుతా ఓకే
and the students feedback from teachers learning one to one teaching will be the best whereas the online classes can be boon for asynchronous learning and pros or cons and as Hippocrates said the dose determines the poison so we have to determine what is the exact dose in which we can use it thank you
well that's one there's an optimal level of what needs to be used would other speakers I would like to give 2 minutes for each of you to close up if you can please go ahead Aruna you can start
sir.
Or yeah please Nivedita please go ahead Nivedita you can go ahead
yes sir just to finish up from my side it is definitely a pro we are here to stay we only have to know about the cons so that we can fix it that is what is my idea because we cannot forego smartphone or internet usage for education in future that is here to stay and we have to, the better we understand that we are not going back to the guru chela system of the old times anymore yep. we have to be in sync with the times and we are going ahead and usage of internet and smartphones in the education of professional courses it has been there even before the pandemic I think many of my friends who are professors do tell me that these children these days don't read textbooks at all yes. they are only reading online all yes. they read is the online material that is available even if you ask them something it is the smartphone they google or they search for the online this thing and then answer in the class
most
many of my friends
Kindle,
had Kindle smartphone
Google.
In the class even if they had to so even the virtual even the in person class had already become a virtual class before and this is we are dealing with for past decade and we have to know the cons so that we can fix it how to fix it as Gopal Krishna sir was rightly saying that we this evil how to make it foolproof is what we have to concentrate more on if we can make it foolproof and turn all the disadvantages into advantages and go ahead that would be a great thing thank you sir
thank you Aruna
sir am I audible
yes you are
sir I would my remark is a quote from Eric Schmidt who was one of the great intellectuals in this internet technology he tells that the internet is the first thing that humanity has built that humanity doesn't understand fully the largest experiment in anarchy that we have ever had the word anarchy is the thing here sir it leads to a lot of lawlessness and the moment we have something inside us to regulate this or balance us as Nivedita rightly pointed out it is not about always that we have to see it in a evil way if we know the cons of it we can definitely strive towards fixing it because as she said maybe it is there to stay we don't know how long the pandemic is going to last having said right. that we will have to adapt ourselves to newer technologies and not just expect that the things will turn back to normal and we'll get back to our classroom where I can throw yeah. chocolates at my students so cool. hope that well, time comes again but in the meantime I think that anarchy has to be brought into a lawful state so that you know we can use it or harness it to the best of our abilities
exactly that well said well said
Aruna, would you like Aruna, just one word on you throwing chalks is a good thing I think it's our time which you are doing you are still doing means you are a good teacher
thank you Pawan would you like to say something please
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Technology is always a double-edged sword, sir. Mm. So one end is always pointing at us. So how best we can mitigate the damages plays the key role. And different sections of the students and different age groups, the needs are different. The supervision that needs to be there is different. So unless these things, if these things are taken care of, then it is definitely advantageous. But as we all know that, you know, women cannot be everywhere at all times. So it's always, I would buy a statement that like, we are not yet completely sure that it is a pro, but we are sure about the cons that it has. So.
Thank you very much, Bhan. I think we are coming to the end of the program. It has been wonderful. All the speakers have put great efforts to put in their points of view. And I think all the listeners would have had a grip of what really smartphone is all about and what it is going to do. So anything which is important to us and technology is something which we cannot bypass. We have to use technology in a judicial way. And I am sure when we are talking about artificial intelligence, number of things have to be algorithm. And I am told time will tell us by the time we meet next year after the COVID gets off from us, hopefully, we should be able to see how smartphones have really changed the way the people have learned. And at the same time, put certain restrictions, just like guidelines for a number of things that have to happen. I'm sure it will happen. Thank you very much for South Zone for giving the opportunity to chair this wonderful session. And thank all the speakers for the wonderful effort. I wish that more questions would have been there in the minds of people. I'm sure we will take it up some other time in some other place. Thank you very much. And good afternoon to everyone. Bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you all.
Hello.
Thank you.
Thank you. That was very wonderful. The panel discussion went very lively. Though we don't want to end the panel discussion, but because of time constraints, we have to close it. And there were expert opinions from all the panelists, and each panelist complimented each other with the par excellence expertise of the moderator. Thank you, sir. Thank you, madam, everyone. Now, I request Dr. Vishal to receive a memento on behalf of Dr. Ganeshan Gopal, sir. Okay. Dr. Vishal will give the memento to Pranavi, Dr. Rajshekar. On behalf of moderator, Dr. Gopalan Ganesh, sir. Dr. Rajshekar will receive the memento on behalf of panelist Dr. Ramanujam. Dr. Rajender will receive the memento on behalf of Dr. Pavan Kulkarni from Dr. Vishal.